The United States Postal Service is old as our country. In 1775, the Continental Congress first approved Benjamin Franklin to be the first Postmaster General. As communication becomes critical for a large country to operate, the government put the Postal Service as a top priority with their desire to expand government westward. The Postal Service issued their first postage stamp in 1847, commemorating Mr. Franklin for his service. 13 years later, the Pony Express first arrived on the scene, offering long-distance, quick delivery service. A package from Sacramento, California, traveling over 1,800 miles to St. Joseph, Missouri, could arrive in just 10 days, barring any complications. In 1863, the post office began offering free delivery in major metropolitan cities, and 30 years later, following suit with daily countryside services. 1918 was when the first scheduled postal service airmail began, reshaping the concept of long-distance delivery. The zip code in 1963 was inaugurated to handle the country's growing suburbs.
Zip code is bringing the mail explosion under control.
1971 saw the United States Postal Service as we know it today begin operations in earnest. In 1994, the Postal Service launched its public internet website, and 25 years later in 2009 offered a smartphone user app. Now, regardless of what the future holds, the United States Postal Service will likely be there to deliver whatever it is directly to your door. The organization's proud history of service comes with its cost in both blood and treasure. The blood and sweat of thousands of workers helping make this enterprise possible, and treasure accounting for the massive amounts of money needed to keep it afloat. The poor financial situation is the most pressing issue facing the organization today. The Postal Service cannot fund its level of financial obligations from its current revenues as compared to other governmental agencies. It has lost $69 billion over the past 11 years, holding debt of $143 billion at the end of fiscal year 2018, all amounting to a very heavy burden to bear. The sharp decline of first-class mail over the past 20 years has continued, from 103 billion pieces of mail in 2000 to just under 55 billion in 2019. A major hurdle for the organization is the Retiree Health Benefits Fund. Since 2010, the USPS has missed its required payment of $5.6 billion over consecutive years now, reaching in excess of $48.2 billion in late payments. In an effort to find cost-saving measures, services were being reduced, shutting down mail processing equipment, slashing the number of blue mailboxes by 23,000 in recent years, and restricting employee overtime. But thankfully, the pandemic hasn't affected USPS operations. Now here's where the politics comes into play. The governing body is constituted of an 11-person board, which includes the Postmaster General, his deputy, and 9 other governors that are appointed by the President and approved by the Senate for 7-year terms. The USPS is not quite a government agency, but still can be influenced by politics. The current board consists of 6 Trump nominees, while 3 slots still remain vacant. A separate 5-member Postal Regulatory Commission oversees rate changes and is appointed by the President and confirmed by the Senate. Through the 2020 CARES Act, Congress imposed their will on the Postal Service with a $10 billion loan that includes strings attached. The previous Postmaster General, David William, resigned in protest over the Treasury Department's interference, stating, "The Treasury demands threaten to turn the agency into a political tool."
"I resigned from the Board of Governors because I was convinced that its independent role had been marginalized, and that representations regarding an independent postal service for the nation were no longer truthful."
In order to get a handle on the situation, they must address their mounting liabilities from the Retiree Health Benefits Fund, a financial mess created by the 2006 Congressional Act called the Postal Accountability Enhancement Act. The legislation is meant to give the Postal Regulatory Commission greater accountability and transparency, while ensuring the RHB account is fully funded well into the future. But the unintended consequences are the USPS has to now pre-fund the retiree account from current revenues. No other entity, nor public or private, is obligated to pre-fund the health benefits for retirees, weakening the USPS, possibly making way for potential privatization. The Congress needs to repeal and revise this act, leveling the playing field for the Postal Service, because only an act of leadership from Congress can remedy the problem. Once the issue of current and long-term liabilities are resolved, then new horizons can be sought after.